Good morning, children. In the previous videos, we discussed up to importance of air for all living things. Now, today we are going to start with new topic, that is, air is necessary for burning or combustion. Now, for this, as we know, different components of air are like oxygen, carbon dioxide, nitrogen, water vapor, impurities, etc. And we also know that among all these components, oxygen is incombustible, but it supports combustion. And this we already have done at page number 99. About oxygen. That is, it is an incombustible gas, but it supports combustion. Now, today we are going to discuss this in detail. That is, oxygen is necessary for burning or oxygen supports burning. Now, man burns many things to produce fire. No substance can burn in the absence of oxygen. Underline, no substance can burn in the absence of oxygen. That is, oxygen is necessary for burning of all substances like wood, coal, paper, etc. So, oxygen is necessary for burning. And without oxygen, burning is not possible. So for this, we have one dictionary over here. That is, fuel plus oxygen. That is, when fuel is burnt in the presence of oxygen, what we get? We get energy. We get energy, and this energy is in the form of heat and light. So along with this energy, we also get water and carbon dioxide. This water is in the form of water vapors. So we can say, whenever we burn fuel in the presence of oxygen, we get energy in the form of heat and light. And along with energy, we also get carbon dioxide and water. So we can say carbon dioxide is released into the air as a result of burning such things. That is, whenever we burn fuel in the presence of oxygen, which gas is released in the atmosphere? It is carbon dioxide. Now, to prove this, we have one activity, that is experiment number 3, to show that burning produces carbon dioxide. Now, for this, what we have to take? We take lime water, test tube, rubber old stopper, glass tube, wooden block, candle and funnel. Now, as I told you, lime water is solution of calcium hydroxide. So first of all, we fill this test tube with lime water and cover this test tube with rubber old stopper. Now, in second step, we place a burning candle over the wooden box and cover the flame of this candle with funnel. After that, dip other end of this funnel in test tube, and at last we suck on the glass tube emerging from the test tube. Now, as we suck on the glass tube, see, this lime water turns milky. That is, the lime water or solution of calcium hydroxide inside the test tube turns milky. So we can say our observation is, the lime water turns milky, thus burning produces carbon dioxide. So how we can say that burning produces carbon dioxide and this lime water turns milky? Because during burning of this candle, carbon dioxide is released, and that carbon dioxide when goes into lime water, then it turns this milky. So we can say the lime water turns milky because of mixing of carbon dioxide produced during the burning in lime water. So this is all about to show that burning produces carbon dioxide. Now, in order to do this, first of all, write down, temperature is directly proportional to rate of burning of fuel. that is speed of burning of fuel. And speed of burning of fuel again directly proportional to quantity of oxygen provided. That is, in order to attain high temperature, what we have to do? We have to increase the rate of burning of fuel or speed of burning of fuel. And speed of burning of fuel is increased by increasing the quantity of oxygen provided. So whenever we have more quantity of oxygen, then burning is more and accordingly temperature is more. So in order to attain a high temperature through the burning of particular fuel, the rate of burning of fuel must be increased. So if a greater quantity of oxygen is provided to the fuel, a larger quantity of fuel will burn at the same time, that is the rate of burning will increase. So again I am going to repeat this paragraph. That is, in order to attain high temperature, what we have to do? We have to increase the rate of burning. We have to increase the rate of burning. And in order to increase rate of burning, we have to increase the quantity of oxygen provided. So this is all about air is necessary for combustion. Next, we have comparison between combustion and respiration. This one is very important. Now, combustion, first point in combustion we have, it is chemical process. That is, combustion is chemical process and respiration is biological process. Means it occur in biological systems. Now, combustion takes place only at high temperature. But respiration takes place at normal temperature, near about 37 degrees Celsius. Now, combustion is fast process. Why it is fast process? Because in this energy is liberated only in one step. So because it is one step process, that's why it is fast process. But respiration is multi-step. That is, there are several steps. So that's why it is slow step. So we can say combustion is fast process, respiration is slow step. In combustion, energy is liberated only in one step, but in respiration, energy is liberated in several steps or in multi steps. Now, next point about combustion, we have most of energy is produced as heat and light. We already have seen over here, fuel plus oxygen, we get energy in the form of heat and light. So in combustion, we get energy in the form of heat and light. But in case of respiration, we get energy only in the form of heat. Only in the form of heat. Now next point is, oxygen is directly used. This we all, again we have seen over here, oxygen is directly used. So because without oxygen, combustion is not possible. So oxygen is directly used in this process. But here oxygen is not directly used, but it is required at the end of reaction. It is required at the end of friction. Now, combustion is artificial and discontinuous. That is, combustion is artificial, not natural, and it is discontinuous process. Discontinuous process means whenever we don't have supply of oxygen, then combustion is not possible. So it is discontinuous. Now, respiration is natural process and it is continuous process. It goes on continue. Now, next is almost all the energy required for industrial as well as domestic purposes. Now, as we know that for industrial works and domestic work, we required energy. And from where we get this energy? We get this energy by burning of fuel like wood, coal, liquefied petroleum gas, that is LPG, and compressed natural gas, that is CNG. So almost all the energy required for industrial as well as domestic purposes is generated by burning fuels such as wood, coal, LPG or CNG, etc. For this purpose, oxygen is necessary. So clear-cut idea about this is, air is necessary for burning. That is, oxygen is necessary for burning, and without oxygen, burning is not possible at all. Now, Next, we have a little activity. Take a leaden jar, open the lid and insert a living cockroach in it. Close the lid tightly. As the jar is closed, the air from outside cannot enter into it. What happened to the cockroach after a few hours? What happened? Cockroach will die because there is no exchange of air. This cockroach will die because the air will not go in. So this is all about this activity. Now next we have very important. It is not safe to sleep under a tree at night. So about this we little bit have done at page number 103 over here. That is at night when process of photosynthesis does not occur. Then what happened? Then process of respiration is there. So we can say that it is not safe to sleep under a tree at night because during night sunlight is not there. So process of photosynthesis is not possible. So what happened? Then respiration is there. And during respiration what happened? Carbon dioxide is released and this carbon dioxide is not useful for us at all. So that's why it is not safe to sleep under a tree at night. So same is written again. You know that respiration and photosynthesis are two important processes of plant. The process of respiration is continuous and it liberates carbon dioxide. At night, in the absence of sunlight, what happens? The tree will undergo only respiration and there will be no photosynthesis. Hence, carbon dioxide gas will be liberated. And so it will not be safe for human beings to sleep under a tree. So in simple words, I am going to repeat it again. It is not safe to sleep under a tree at night because at night there is no sun, no photosynthesis. So only respiration is there in case of plants. And in a respiration, carbon dioxide is released and carbon dioxide gas will be liberated and so it will not be safe for human beings to sleep under a tree at night. Our next topic is rusting. For this, I want to give you an example. Like at your home, you must have noticed sometime iron objects covered with brown colored powder. That brown colored powder is known as rust, and process of forming brown colored powder from iron is known as dusting. That is, when iron objects are exposed to oxygen and moisture for long time, then rust is formed. Now, this rust has chemical formula hydrate iron oxide. Hydrate means water or moisture. Iron means iron object and oxide means oxygen. And this hydrate iron oxide is reddish brown in color. Color of this hydrate iron oxide is reddish brown. So clear cut definition of rusting we have, you can write it. The process of forming reddish brown coating of hydrate iron oxide on the iron objects in the presence of oxygen and moisture is known as rusting. So here we need two things, that is oxygen and moisture or oxygen and water for the process of rusting. So again in this paragraph, when some iron objects are exposed to air and moisture for a long time, they slowly react with oxygen, underline, react with oxygen of the atmosphere in the presence of moisture, underline, moisture. A reddish brown coating called rust is formed on the iron objects. And this process is known as dusting or corrosion. This process is also known as corrosion. The reddish brown coating is chemically known as hydrate iron oxide. That is, chemical formula of rust is hydrate iron oxide. What is chemical formula of rust? It is hydrate iron oxide. Now from all these points we came to know that there are two main conditions for rusting. That these are oxygen and moisture. That is, without the presence of oxygen and moisture, rusting is not possible. So here in mode to know, we have two main conditions, that is the necessary conditions for rusting of iron are presence of oxygen and presence of moisture. So these are the two important conditions required for rusting of iron. Next, we have important methods to prevent rusting. That is how we can prevent rusting of iron. So this can be done by painting, by greasing, by electroplating, and by galvanizing. In all these methods, we mainly break the contact of iron with oxygen and moisture. Like in painting, we paint our iron objects and break the contact of that iron objects with air and moisture. Same in greasing, we apply grease like oil over the iron objects. In electroplating, what we do, the process of plating one metal onto the another, that is, we cover one metal with another metal. In galvanizing, we cover steel and iron with zinc. So galvanizing is same as that of electroplating, but here we cover steel or iron with zinc. This process is known as galvanizing. Next, we have activity to show that air and moisture are necessary for rusting. For this, take three test tubes and label them as A, B and C. Now, place two polished iron nails in each test tube. That is two in A, two in B and two in C. After that, put some anhydrous calcium chloride on a layer of cotton. Now, anhydrous calcium chloride means, anhydrous means without water. That is, in anhydrous calcium chloride, there is no amount of water. So, again, with this cotton containing anhydrous calcium chloride, cover test tube A. Now, in case of test tube B, fill it with boiled water. Now, what happens in case of boiled water? On boiling the water, oxygen in water escapes. That is, in boiled water, we don't have oxygen. So we can say that test tube B is free from oxygen. That is, there is no oxygen. There is only boiled water and there is no oxygen. After that, cover this water with a thick layer of oil. Now, in case of test tube C, just fill tap water. There is only tap water. So notice, after some days, what happened? Iron nails in test tube A do not rust. Iron nails in test tube B also do not rust, but iron nails in test tube C get rusted. So these iron nails in test tube C get rusted. Why so? Because in case of test tube A, we don't have water, and as well as we don't have air. In case of B, we have water, but air is not there. But in case of C, tap water is there and air is also there. So because of air and water, that is moisture, iron nails in this test tube get rusted. So by this way, we can show that air and moisture are necessary for rusting.